Lord be with you. Good morning and welcome to worship at Madison Square Presbyterian Church, or with Madison Square Presbyterian Church, I suppose I should say. We're so happy to have all of you here online with us. I have a few announcements for the life of the church this morning. Just adjust my screen just a little bit. We are working on our partnership in Cuba with our sister church in Cuba. There are two ways we can connect with them, and we invite you to think about considering doing this. One is simply by being a pen pal, and that is not, it's actual letter writing or card writing. Snail mail is the best means, because internet is spotty in Cuba. And so they are, our partners are finding people who would like to be pen pals. And so if you would like to be a pen pal, you can email Rebecca Baker, or contact Rebecca, and she can get you set up with a pen pal. In addition, we're looking for a leadership team to organize and think about how to connect with our sister church in Cuba once we're able to travel in particular. But there's much planning that can go into that. If you're interested in being part of the team that organizes how our relationship works with the Cuba church, then you can email Edwin or I or me for that information. Sorry, we've got a few messages flying around for technical notes, and so we'll see how we're doing. It looks like you get to see all of us this morning on Facebook for a little bit, and so we'll figure that out. On that note, I want to welcome Natasha Beck-King as our host, and along with Rolando, we're finding a few more folks to help us with the tech to have online worship. So we're very thankful for their behind the scenes work. Also, we have Rogelio with us as a liturgist this morning, and so we're very happy to have Rogelio with us. And so both of those are opportunities for other folks. If you're interested in being a liturgist on Sunday mornings as part of worship, we would love to see your face. You just need to have an internet connection and a camera, and we would love to have you. So if you're interested in being a liturgist for us or with us to help lead worship, then please contact Pastor Jen or me, and we will make sure that we get you signed up for that. And as always, we are looking for people to record small videos of the welcome home and the presentation of gifts when we use the font and the table and the Bible. And so we have a script that we can send you to let you know what it is that we say during the presentation of gifts. We would love to have you record it so we can compile it all together and also have you be a part of worship in that way. All right, and now let us take a moment, take a deep breath, be as present as possible, know that we were gathered through the web as the body of Christ, and let us prepare to worship God.
Esta es la fuente de identidad. This is the font of identity.
Esta es la mesa de sustento. This is the table of sustenance.
Esta es el libro de memoria y esperanza. This is the book of memory and hope.
Bienvenidos, children of God, welcome home.
The Bible says, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation.
Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new.
The Bible says, behold,
God is doing a new thing.
But the Bible also says, what has been is what will be.
There is nothing new under the sun.
So what are we to believe? Are we doomed to repeat our past, or is something new coming?
Yes, we continue to struggle with the same issues, but God continues to create. And so, despite our repeated history, nothing is beyond the love and power of God. Let us worship God together.
God, we come before you and confess our sins, things we have done and things we have left undone. We confess that we have arrogantly assumed that we are more better than a virus and better than others. We confess that we have allowed racial and economic social injustice to exist long before COVID-19 and unjust deaths made them more apparent. We confess that we don't make reconciliation a priority. When we gather to worship, we remember your mighty deeds, but wonder if you will show up now. We are now succeeding in working together. We are not succeeding in working together. We are not caring about one another enough. We need you. Jesus showed us how to live and pray even in troubled times. Yet rather than turn to you, we fill our hearts and minds with things that bring us down and tear us apart. Forgive us, God, for the many ways we have failed as your creation to care for you and one another. The desire to please God pleases God. The prayer of confession is heard. The contrite heart is met with God's compassion every single time.
We sin, are forgiven, and sin again. May it never be an excuse to keep sinning, but a reminder that we never reach the limit of God's abundant mercy. Thanks be to God.
I will bring you home.
May the peace of Christ be with you. I invite you to, that's okay. We're having a few technical things. That's not a problem. So you just got a preview of what's coming. We invite you to pass a sign of the peace. If you're sheltering with folks around you, of course, share the peace with them. If you are sheltering in place physically by yourself, we invite you to text a friend or to pass the peace of Christ to one another. Let us share the peace of Christ with each other. So I invite those young and young at heart to get a little closer to your screen. I've got a book to share with you this morning, one of my favorite books, one of my favorite authors, Mo Willems, is a children's author, and I wanted to share with you Naked Mole Rat Gets Dressed. There is so much to learn about the fascinating little creatures known as naked mole rats. But for this story, you only need to know three things. One, they're a little bit rat. Two, they're a little bit mole. 3, they are all naked. Well, they were, with one exception. Look, Wilbur, the naked mole rat who liked to get dressed. Hello. When the other naked mole rat saw him, they said, "Ew, yuck, what are you doing?" "I like clothes," replied Wilbur. "When I get dressed, I can be fancy, or funny, or cool, or I can just be an astronaut." When the others heard that, they said, "Ew, yuck. If you like clothes so much, then why don't you open a store or something?" Naked mole rats can be very sarcastic. But Wilbur thought that was a great idea. See, look, he opened a clothing store. The other naked mole rats did not. They brought Wilbur to a giant portrait of Grandpa, the oldest, greatest, and most naked mole rat ever. "Look at that picture," they demanded. "Look at his heroic face. Look at his regal bearing. Look at his total lack of clothing." Grandpa did look heroic. Grandpa did look regal. But he would also look heroic and regal in a casual shirt and some summer slacks. "Ugh," said the other naked mole rats. "Don't you get it? Naked mole rats don't wear clothes." "Why not?" asked Wilbur. Something had to be done. The naked mole rats marched right over to Grandpa and told him all about Wilbur. And then he asked, "Why not?" Grandpa was very wise. He thought seriously about everything he had heard. Then he thought some more. Finally, he said in a heroic, regal voice, "Gather the colony. I shall make a proclamation." When Wilbur heard about Grandpa's proclamation, he knew it was serious. A proclamation, a proclamation, a proclamation. But he had no idea what to wear. In the end, Wilbur decided to play it safe. Maybe not safe enough. The others were so busy looking at Wilbur's socks that no one noticed Grandpa enter until he cleared his throat and proclaimed, "Fellow naked mole rats, I had never worn clothes until I heard Wilbur's simple question, why not? Why not indeed? Do clothes hurt anyone? No. Are they fun? Well, they may not be for everyone, but this old naked mole rat wishes he had tried getting dressed earlier." Then Grandpa complimented Wilbur on his socks. As fast as his legs could take him, Wilbur rushed home, put on his favorite outfit, and dashed back. When he returned, Wilbur discovered he was not alone. Much has been said about that day, but for this story, you only need to know 3 things. 1, some of the mole rats were naked. 2, some of the mole rats were clothed. 3, all of the mole rats had a great time. The end. So I wanted to share that story with you today, because not only is it fun, and not only do I love Mo Willems, but I've been thinking a lot this week about proclamations and about community, because we have celebrated July 4th this weekend, just yesterday, where we have proclaimed our independence, where our founding fathers got together and made a proclamation that they were going to be free of tyranny. And so I thought a lot about what that means. And interestingly enough, we have freedom and independence in our faith as well. But sometimes it means going against the grain of what the rest of the world does. It means going a different way. It means trying something new and having the courage to be yourself. And I think that sometimes when we get that courage, when we're able to be who we truly are, it gives permission for other people to be who they are as well. And so I encourage you this weekend as we celebrate our freedom in our faith, as we celebrate the freedom of this country, that you get to proclaim who you are and that you get to help others be who they truly are. Let's pray together. Gracious God, thank you for our freedom. Thank you for making us unique and different. Give us courage to be truly who we are, so that we can help others be who they truly are. Amen.
Now, if you would continue in prayer with me, we'll prepare for our scripture reading. Holy One, speak to us today through your word. It is our book of memory and hope, our past and our future. Amen. Share with you our scripture for today. It comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 43. We are continuing in our discussion about Isaiah. Pastor Bart covered Isaiah 40. Our guest preacher Kendall discussed Isaiah 42, and this is from Isaiah 43, all from the same thread of thought. But now, thus says the Lord, the one who created you, O Jacob, the one who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away, and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. Bring forth the people who are blind yet have ears, eyes, who are deaf yet have ears. Let all the nations gather together, and let the peoples assemble. I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. I declared and saved and proclaimed when there was no strange God among you, and you are my witnesses, says the Lord. I am God, and also henceforth I am the Lord. There is no one who can deliver from my hand. I work, and who can hinder it? Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. For your sake, I will send to Babylon and break down all the bars, and the shouting of the Chaldeans will be turned into lamentation. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things, or consider the things of old. I am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Several years back, when we had an African-American president, Ellen DeGeneres dancing every afternoon on television, and an increasing public approval of universal background checks for firearms and legalization of marijuana, I had this naive optimism that my generation and the one that followed would bring a new wave of leadership to this country that would once and for all end systemic racism and sexism, make every wage a living wage, reform the justice system and immigration system, and improve the education and healthcare systems. I truly believed that we were witnessing the extinction of the KKK. I was sure that we would see a female first lady and be on our way to a female majority on the Supreme Court and in Congress. I mean, if you look at the arc of a history, consider how much things have changed in the last 70 years. Interracial marriage and gay marriage are legal. Voting rights have been expanded, though voting isn't as straightforward and easy as it should be. Public schools have technically been desegregated, though that system isn't equitable yet either. The military allows people of all races and genders to serve together. Women are fighter pilots. You can be out and in uniform, though the trans community still needs our full support. There are no separate water fountains or assigned seats in public transportation for people of different skin color in restaurants or buses or airplanes. But since 2016, I've resonated with the writer of Ecclesiastes that what has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, look, this is something new? No, it was already here long ago. It was here before our time. We are so far from justice. We all know that our city demographics, even here in San Antonio, are defined primarily by ethnicity, and that our schools reflect that in terms of budgets and resources. We know that a white person is far less likely to ever interact with law enforcement than a person of color. We know that a white high school dropout will have a higher net worth than a black college graduate. And we know that generations of inequality and racism have created a truly oppressive system. Evil and oppression, hatred, jealousy, envy, the temptations of money and drugs and power, the truly awful parts of the world. They have existed for thousands of years. And though we've made some progress in the last century, the leadership of the KKK just keeps being handed down from one generation to the next. We haven't wiped it out or silenced it. It was just underground for a little while. There is nothing new under the sun. I've been thinking about Ecclesiastes in relation to our pandemic too. There have been loads of comparisons between COVID-19 and the Spanish flu of 1918. Nothing new under the sun. Viruses like measles, mumps, rubella, smallpox, and polio all wreaked havoc on the world before vaccines were discovered. But the Spanish flu was particularly horrific and contagious. Did you know that it didn't originate in Spain? I've been doing a little reading on this. In 1918, World War I was raging. The governments engaged in the war recognized that a virus was spreading, but they chose to stifle the reports and the number to keep public morale up. Spain, at the time, was still neutral, and its press was free to report reality. The number of cases being reported in Spain were rising faster than the numbers that were being reported elsewhere. So the world labeled it the Spanish flu. How about that, huh? Aren't we glad we have a free press now? When the virus began to spread in 1918, the advice was the same as it is now. Distance yourselves, use good hygiene, and wear a mask. I want to show you some images that I found that describe what people were going through. And for those of you who are tuning in only through your telephones in audio format, I'm going to describe them to you. The first is a picture of a cowboy. He's wearing a hat and he's got a cloth over his nose and mouth. And the sign says, wear your masks, obey the city ordinance. When the virus kept spreading, the governments intervened and required closures of public places and gatherings. Here's a notice about closing schools, churches, lodges, conventions, and places of amusement like movie theaters now and bars and bowling alleys and beaches and restaurants. Do you realize, teachers and students, that 100 years ago, schools were closed because of a disease? There is nothing new under the sun. Though the virus raged, people still demanded amusement, so sports was able to continue. Here's a picture of a crowd at a Georgia Tech football game. Everyone, all the men, it's men, in the stands, they're all wearing masks. There's one gentleman in the upper right who has it under his nose, but everyone pretty much is wearing the masks more efficiently than we even do today. And look at this, a picture of a baseball player at the plate in a mask. And if you look closely at the umpire and the catcher and the fans in the background, I feel pretty sure that they're all wearing masks too. Here's a picture of a barbershop. The chairs are outside. You can see the dirt floor. The barbers are wearing masks. The gentleman waiting to get a haircut is in a mask. And as we've all learned, it's difficult to get a haircut while you're wearing a mask. So the people getting their haircut weren't wearing masks, but you can see how important it was at the time. There is nothing new under the sun. This is a picture of an auditorium in Oakland, California that was being turned into a field hospital because the hospitals there were out of beds. In the early months of 1919, a second wave hit and masks were required again. An anti-mask league was formed in one city and it had over 2,000 members. There were police that were hired, not to arrest people, but to advise the importance of wearing a mask. And if people refused, they would gather their names and bring them to the government, and repeated offenses would be met with a fine. Here's the notice for the anti-mask meeting at the Dreamland Rink to protect against the unhealthy mask ordinance. And an extract would be read showing that compulsory mask wearing is a failure. There is nothing new under the sun. Since 2016, I have found myself swinging from pessimism to optimism and back again. There have been moments of joy, but many moments of shock and grief and anger. I truly thought that with small pockets of injustice, we would mostly move on beyond systemic problems, but there is nothing new under the sun. The scripture for today is about a people who were in exile in Babylon. It wasn't the first time that the children of Abraham were in a foreign country. The Hebrew people had spent an enormous part of their history outside of the land Abraham was told he would give to his descendants forever. The foundation of the Hebrew faith is the story of how God delivered them from Egypt. So for the people living in Babylon, who Isaiah is addressing here, there is nothing new under the sun. They yearn for deliverance again from an oppressive regime. They also wonder if their prayers are reaching God's ears. They yearn for their homeland again. They resonate deeply with their ancestors who were forced to build pyramids, and they agree with the writer of Ecclesiastes that there is nothing new under the sun. And when Isaiah delivers the words of God, God identifies with their past. God says, "I am the God of Jacob. I am the Lord, your Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out the chariot and horse, army and warrior. They slide down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished like a wick." All of this introduction speaks to what God did and the exodus from Egypt. It's a comfort to the people that God was powerful and worked on their behalf. And then in a complete 180, God says in Isaiah 43, do not remember the past, do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. What? It feels sometimes like half of faith in God is remembering what God has done in the past. Every Sunday, we open the scriptures, not the Sunday paper. We open the book of memory and hope, past and future, and read something about what the Trinity was involved in millennia ago, while pointing out how relevant it is today. Hymns remind us of events of the past and give us joy for tomorrow. What is our faith if it isn't at least a little bit of looking back? Well, I don't think God meant that it is wrong to appreciate or learn from history. I think it would be wrong to ignore it. I think, though, we can get stuck on the memory part and forget about the hope. The troubles we face in the present get us lulled into thinking that God was active a long time ago and is passive now, that when Jesus came and the Spirit afterward, that God took a rest, and now it's more our responsibility to act and less about God's intervention. I think that's what God means by do not remember the former things, because the next line is, I am about to do a new thing. A new thing. For the Hebrew people exiled in Babylon, I think this must have blown their theology out of the water. The siege of Jerusalem that they experienced, the destruction of their homes, the destruction of the throne of God at the temple, had suggested to them that either God had been defeated by Babylonian gods, or God had given up on a faithless people. Both options were spiritually devastating. But Isaiah's message to them over the last few chapters that Pastor Bart and Reverend Kendall have been discussing is, take comfort. You are still my people. I am still with you. I'm about to give birth to justice, and I'm going to do something amazing and new. God says that the people will return from all directions, from all the places they had been scattered because of famine, invasion, exile, and defeat. God says there will be a new temple, not as grand as before, but now you know you don't need a temple to have God with you. I am with you right here. I am with you wherever you go. You are mine. On the one hand, there will be a second temple and a second exodus out of bondage because there is nothing new under the sun. But on the other hand, God never does things the same way. In Egypt, 10 plagues were sent before the people escaped to the desert and wandered around for 40 years. But in Babylon, Cyrus, the Persian king, is coming and will defeat the Babylonians and will encourage the Hebrew people to go back to their homes and will give them a large sum of money to use for their safe journey and the rebuilding of their homes and the temple. I don't have any idea that any of them would imagine that would ever happen. How often do we lack the imagination to envision God's intervention? How often do we resign ourselves to the present situation, feeling that we've deserved the circumstances we're in, that God wouldn't find us valuable enough to intervene in a big way, that we're mostly dependent upon ourselves and a small group of friends and family? How often do we just look back on the good old days and take consolation in how far we've come? God is telling us, stop focusing on the past. You are still my people. I'm still your God. I'm still capable of new things. I think we resign ourselves sometimes. The people in power especially, they know that if they can ride out the first wave of a movement, it'll lose momentum. If they can form an information gathering committee, the demands for a quick fix and justice now will be silenced by the call for responsible slowness. But we can't become complacent and let this momentum wane. Thousands of African Americans have been denied mortgage loans and job interviews and promotions and lines of credit. Thousands of African Americans have been incarcerated for crimes white people aren't arrested for. More African Americans are behind bars for months before their trials or accept plea deals just because they can't access bail money. And more die violently than ever should. Emancipation is not something that happens once. Emancipation has to happen over and over and over to a minority of people who are systemically oppressed. The Hebrew people were delivered out of Egypt, but after that, they were oppressed and defeated and oppressed again by Assyrians and Babylonians and other neighboring groups, then the Greeks and the Romans, and in our time, the Nazis and the neo-Nazis. There is nothing new under the sun. For our African American family, generation after generation feel the oppression. The Emancipation Proclamation was issued on September 22nd, 1862. It didn't go into effect until January 1st of the next year, but as we know, news of the Confederate defeat and emancipation didn't reach good old Texas until June 19th of 1965. And even then, we as a church recognize that emancipation is not something that brought total equality and total liberty. Land ownership, voting rights, equal access to education, housing, transportation, careers, a voice in government didn't come all at once and still aren't a reality for many. It's still not safe for them to be in predominantly white neighborhoods or even enter stores with hoodies on. They still can't get mortgage loans or job promotions as easily. White people don't buy and sell humans in a market anymore, but we still keep our knees on their necks, physically, financially, emotionally. And if any of us say, "Now, I've never done that," then we need to re-examine our privilege. We have centuries of sin to atone for. God is about to do a new thing. Stop focusing on what God has done in the past. Yes, God can emancipate people and does. God has led people from bondage to freedom, but imagine what's coming down the pipe. Something new is coming. We haven't seen the end of this glory. Like Kendall said last week, justice is being birthed. It can't be held back. New freedom, new power is on the way. The struggle won't ever truly be over, but because hatred will continue to exist. There is nothing new under the sun. Racism has never and may never be truly eradicated, but God is doing something new. And I'm super excited to see what's in store. I'm excited to hear the name of a woman of color as a vice presidential candidate. I'm excited to hear white people say with conviction that Black lives matter. I'm excited to see voter registration going up. I'm excited to see people of all colors, law enforcement officers, Catholic bishops, lawmakers, take a knee for 8 minutes and 46 seconds. I'm excited to know and to see what God has in store. Something new is coming. Despite our broken records of jealousy and selfishness and pride, anger and fear, God is not a broken record. Except to say, do not fear, I am with you. God keeps creating, keeps responding in new ways. Watch, God says. Stop dwelling in the past. You can have a story that grounds your faith. You can identify with an event from the past, but don't let it keep you from imagining a creative new future. There is nothing new under the sun. But God doesn't live under the sun. God dwells in the heavens above the sun, and new things are possible with God. Watch out. It's coming, and it's going to be amazing. Amen. In just a moment, friends, we're going to have a song from Paul. And at that time, I would encourage you that if you have prayer requests, that you would send them to me through a text or a chat on Zoom or through the Facebook messaging system, the message system in the live feed that we're doing. If I miss it, I apologize, and I promise I will pray for it through the week. Take a moment now to enjoy this song from Paul.
I thought sooner or later the lights up above would come down in circles and guide me to love. But I don't know what's right for me, I cannot see straight. I've been here too long and I don't want to wait for it. Fly like a cannonball straight to my soul. Tear me to pieces and make me feel whole. I'm willing to fight for it and carry this weight. But with every step I keep questioning what is true. Fall on me with open arms. Fall on me wherever you are. Fall on me with all your light, with all your light, with all your light. Soon you will find what your heart wants to know. Don't give up hope, for I know you are close. And all you have ever dreamed, wish you could ever be, is waiting to find you wherever you go. Yourself every step that you take, knowing I'm smiling with pride every day. My love will be forever stronger than stone. Don't be afraid, you are never alone. Fall on me with open arms. Fall on me wherever you are. Fall on me with all your light, with all your light, with all your light, with all your see you everywhere. I step outside, it's like I'm breathing you in the air. I can feel you there. Fall on me with open arms. Fall on me wherever
I invite you to join me in the invitation to the Lord's Supper. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty."
Jesus is not bound to a specific place, specific elements, or specifically ordained people. We believe that Christ is present with us by the Holy Spirit, whenever and wherever we, the church, share this sacrament.
So the table you are using right now is no longer your table. It is part of Christ's table, and you are sitting spiritually next to one another, just as the disciples sat around the table in the upper room in Jerusalem. Come, church, to the table of grace.
We come as we are with what we have. It is enough. Christ invites us to sit and eat and drink together to remember the gift of his saving grace and our connections to one another through his wondrous love. The Holy One be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to God.
Let us give thanks to our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
God who breathed over the waters, Spirit whose breath animated all living creatures, Jesus who gave a last breath pleading for forgiveness for others, you are magnificent. Enthroned in heaven where angels sing your praises and light shines eternally, your presence is what we long for. Love flows from you to us, your creation, but anguish flows from us to your ears. Anguish over what we have done to ourselves and our planet. Anguish over pain and diagnoses and violence and injustice. But the same cries have been lifted to you since the beginning, and you've heard them all. You send angels and prophets and messages to us over and over. You birth justice into hopelessness. You make roads in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. So show us the path to your kingdom. Guide us toward your glory and we'll run to get there. But the journey requires sustenance. So bless us with your grace through this meal we are about to eat. In all of our houses, apartments, and patios, take what humble elements we have gathered from our kitchens and imbue them with your grace and mercy, so that we might carry you within us to face the challenges of the next days and weeks. In your magnificent Son's name we pray. Amen.
On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his disciples in an upper room, and he took bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Whenever you eat of this, do this in remembrance of me."
In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup and he poured it out, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed by my blood shed for you. Whenever you drink of it, remember me." Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the life and death and resurrection of the Lord until he returns. Take and drink. Let us continue in prayer. Merciful God, filled with your presence through these elements we have received, we are stronger, braver, more faith-filled than we were this morning. When you do new things, we will anticipate and be ready. When you challenge us to be a part of it, we'll be fed and anxious to begin. When we are struggling and afraid, your supper will help us to hang on. Your supper reminds us that we are not alone. We eat the bread together and drink the cup together. We are still the church. We are still Madison Square. We have very real concerns today. Infections are out of control. Now almost all of us know someone personally who has had COVID-19. We pray for those who are sick, for those who love them, and those who care for them. We pray for Emil, that he might make a full recovery from the illness he's dealing with. We pray for firefighter Ronnie Fikes, who is on a ventilator with COVID-19. For Louis Lubbering, who's dealing with COVID-19. And for Teresa, who wants to support Louis's family and friends. We pray for Lynn and Kay, Rob Shaw Meadows' sister and mother, who are battling the disease. We pray for Celine, an 18-year-old girl who lost her mother, Kelly Alvarado, yesterday from COVID-19. And for Kelly's school where she worked, Sunshine Cottage, and all the children and families and teachers who will miss her dearly. God, we pray for the humility, cooperation, and patience to love one another selflessly at this time. We trust that you have heard all that we have voiced and all that has gone unshared and unspoken. We know that all of us have concerns and we could spend all afternoon in prayer together. So we ask that this week we might take a bit more of your time and lift our hearts up to you more often. Whether we cry or ramble or get distracted or write it out, we know that you will hear it all. So we close this prayer, but continue the conversation with you, praying together the prayer Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, as we leave from here, know that you are loved and prayed for, and that God knows your name and is with you. Will you join me, please? God created the world and all that is in it.
God is going to do a new thing.
God made us co-creators, and God continues to create.
God is going to do a new thing.
And we can help bring about the kingdom.
And we're going to be a part of its creation if we commit to move forward from lament to action.
Friends, be safe, be healthy, stay home as much as you can. We'll see you next week. God is for you. Be at peace. Amen.